Hello, everyone, and welcome to this bonus episode of Independent Thought. My name is Desmond Price, and I am joined today by Esther and Betta, two students at the University of Montana. Thank you for so much for coming on the show today. How are you both doing?
I'm pretty good. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you for coming on today. So one of the reasons I was asking you two to come on today was to talk about Professor Rob Smith, who we learned just earlier today, has recently resigned from the University of Montana, but I feel like there's still plenty to talk about with this particular story. So I'm thankful for both of you to come on today and talk with me about this issue. Just first and foremost, for those who are unaware, could you both just kind of like highlight for those who might not know or might not be totally familiar with, what exactly happened with Professor Rob Smith at University of Montana, and why were people wanting him to be fired from the university?
A couple of weeks ago, it came out that he had published a series of blog posts saying all kinds of terrible things about women, about LGBTQ plus people, Muslim people, trans people, and particularly his students, targeting these statements about his students, and also statements saying that women peak sexually at 16 and men should try and marry girls as close to 16 as possible, and just a whole suite of really terrible things. And an article came out in our school newspaper, The Chi-Minh, about it. And we worked with a group of students to set up a website, social media, a petition to have him fired, all under the name Fire Rob Smith. And he went under investigation and he was placed on leave immediately, which was a good step on the part of the university, and we just found out that he resigned. So it's been a lot of things happening these past couple of weeks, but we are glad that that's been our goal this whole time, is to get him out of the university and away from students.
It turns out the investigation was actually happening before the article came out in the Chi-Minh, but they actually publicized it, which doesn't usually happen with Title IX investigations, but there was a lot of people that started filing reports after the article came out because they realized that they had also been discriminated against and wanted to do something about it.
Absolutely. And so I guess just to kind of go into a little bit further details about exactly what was on that blog, would you mind just sharing like just a little bit more specifics about what it was that he said specifically that most people thought should lead to his termination, just so that, for those who don't know, they might have a better, more clear picture.
We can read a few quotes for sure. There's some pretty terrible things in there. On our homepage of our website, we have a few. So in one of his articles titled "The Problem with the Women," he says, "Did you know that women peak physically at age 16? It's interesting that modern society has made it taboo for a man to marry a 16-year-old or so woman, suggesting that it's inappropriate to find a 16-year-old or so woman attractive." Another one: "One false idea widely promoted is that girls should experience the same kind of education as boys." And there's another one: "The fact is that one cannot be both a peaceful Muslim and a faithful Muslim. In other words, Muslims are the only peaceful to the degree that they are not Muslims." And yeah, it goes on. It's way worse.
There's other quotes that are very homophobic, and a lot of them are very sexist and ageist and ableist, and there's just a lot there.
Right. So I think one of the striking details that I heard from this story is that the University of Montana actually knew about this blog before they even hired him. Is that correct?
I think that's a miscommunication.
Okay.
I think, I'm not entirely sure on the details, but I think that's been kind of like a telephone thing. I do know that there was people who had kind of researched him a little bit when he went up for tenure, but I don't think they knew to the extent how bad the blog was. But again, we don't know the whole full details of the investigation or how long this has been going on. So,
I talked to Jesse Johnson, who's the chair, and he knew about a singular post from the blog that was just religious stuff, I think, but all it said was Rob, and there was no YouTube channel at that point, so there was no way to tell it was actually him. And also, that particular post didn't necessarily have anything that they found disturbing, so they didn't look any further into it, is what I heard. But
Okay. So he had a blog out there. I believe the blog's name was Upward Thought, and also a corresponding YouTube channel where there was insanely long diatribes that he would go on about several issues that were also found in the blog. So U of M might not have known precisely about everything at the time of hire, but let's kind of talk about how they've been handling this altogether. Now, do you believe that they've been handling this correctly since all this information has come out?
I think in terms of the, after all of this went public and there was the article and our publicity, it was heartening to hear that the university, like within a couple hours, put out a statement that he was under investigation, he'd been placed on leave, he wasn't allowed back on campus. So I think that was a really good step. That's what we expected. But it is concerning that there had been warning signs for a while before all of this was unearthed, and that didn't really seem like anything came of that. And so that's kind of what we're working on now, is trying to find ways to prevent things like this from happening, and trying to find ways that if students and faculty know that there are these red flags, how do we incorporate this into the tenure process or things like that to try and prevent this from happening again?
Yeah, and to be clear here, the issue with this professor is not just the blog. There's a lot of concrete things that he's done that are discriminatory and not okay. And a lot of them just haven't been publicized because people who are victims of this don't really want that story coming out about themselves. And so the blog is just kind of the way of letting the public know like what is going on with this person. But yeah, I worked for Rob and had a really bad experience, and I know other women who've had similar experiences. So this has been happening for a while.
Yeah. And honestly, I think it, unfortunately, it speaks to a larger culture at the University of Montana, as they've had similar issues around their law school currently, where also there were Title IX claims filed recently. So I guess the question now becomes, Rob Smith has stepped down from the University of Montana. So I'm sure some people might think that this story is over, but other people might think that this story is not over. So I guess my next question for you both is, how do you think this story is important moving forward, not just for students, but also for the University of Montana as a whole?
Yeah. So we're working with the department and with the administration to try and get some change to happen to prevent things from going this way again. And Betta can give more details on that.
Yeah, I think there's been interest in the department in trying to make changes to like incorporate discussions around diversity in computer science into our classes and things like that, that they're definitely, that's one step we can take. But also, this isn't just isolated to the computer science department. There's students who have experiences like this all across campus. And I think that's why we've been trying to also reach out to people around campus who are working on diversity initiatives and talking with them and trying to figure out what are people already working on to make campus better and more inclusive. And there are a lot of things that are happening, but I think the next step is to try and make some of these plans more enforceable, or to hold people accountable, to really follow through on making campus a more inclusive place. So it's not just talk, that it actually results in action.
Yeah, for example, the administration has their diversity, equity, and inclusion plan, but there's no actual way to enforce it at the moment. And so they're reaching out to us and other students to try and figure out how they can enforce it and actually put that into the plan.
Right. And so that's great that the university is definitely listening to you and hearing your concerns. I guess my final question is, if, you know, at the end of the day, the university should be responsible for the practices that happen at the university, their professors, so on and so forth. What is one thing that the University of Montana could do in order to prove to you that they've taken this situation seriously and that they actually do want to change the culture at the university moving forward?
I think, listen to us. We've got some plans in the works, and eventually, hopefully, we'll come up with some kind of proposal, or student groups will. The ASUM, the Student Senate, is working on things as well. And I hope that when we come forward with something, we have proposals, I hope they listen to us and try and implement those changes.
Absolutely. Well, thank you both so much for coming on today. Are there any links that we could that people can go to in order to learn more about the story or learn more about both of you?
Yeah, so one important link would be the original Kaiman article that came out a couple weeks ago that has a lot of good context about the situation. And then also the website that we created to share people's share information with people. And then also a link to the Title IX office at UM, because if anyone hasn't reported any instance of discrimination that they've experienced or witnessed, that's a good place you can go to help let the university know about red flags and stuff.
Okay. Well, thank you both so much. I really do appreciate you coming on to the show today and talking about this issue. I can appreciate this has probably been a very trying time the last few weeks, months, that this has all been, you know, a lived experience for the both of you. So thank you again for coming on. And for those who are interested in those links, they will be in the episode description. So go ahead and click into the description right now, and you'll be able to see those links and get in contact where you want to. So thank you both again for coming on the show today. And for everyone else, I'll see you in the next video. Take care.
Thank you.